So, Cyril, hopefully you have somehow been keeping track of participation, because I think that would be something good to know if we ever do this again. I think by my estimates, most of these events we are getting between 13 and 20 people. But that would be something good to share with Omalaye, maybe, or your partner, so they'll know the impact of our programming.
Yes. I sent the update last week regarding the numbers.
Okay.
Yeah, so I also screenshot the list, like the total number of attendees as well to her, so she could also keep it in a record.
Okay.
So
All right.
yeah. So, because she's been busy with some TV sessions. In fact, I was invited to come for a TV interview today, but I told her that I'll be doing some other stuff, so she said no problem to next week. So yeah.
All right, I think I'm going to go ahead and get started, but if you all could monitor the chat in the waiting room and let anyone who comes in, that would be wonderful. So welcome, welcome everyone. Today is our last in a series of outreach activities between Black and robotics, and particularly organizations in Nigeria, although we did call it an Africa outreach. I am Carlotta Berry, and I'm a professor and Lawrence Giacoletto Endowed Chair in Electrical and Computer Engineering at Rose Holman Institute of Technology. And today, topic is robotics as a game changer, bias in artificial intelligence. Although this is not my primary research area, I get asked about it a lot, and so it has become a topic that me, as well as some of the other co-founders of Black and Robotics, speak about frequently. So what you're going to hear today is a compilation of several of those presentations. And I think it's important because no matter what area of research you do in robotics, you always got to keep the human in the loop. And you always have to be cognizant of how your technology affects individuals, and particularly those who may be from communities that are more likely to experience discrimination or bias. So that's what we're going to talk about today. I'm going to talk a little bit first about myself, my journey to STEM, what my research is, and then how all of it connects together to make us aware of bias. So I would be remiss if I did not highlight our partners in this endeavor, TechEdHub, as you hub, as well as Angela Wells and Cyril, who worked together to bring this to fruition because they saw the importance of Black and robotics doing outreach beyond the United States, in particular to Africa. And so this is our last series. Over the last several weeks, we've done something for elementary kids, for middle school and high school, which were very well received. And today is our final event, which is a lecture on, as you guessed, AI bias in robotics. So the mission of Black in Robotics is to bring together Black researchers, professionals, academics, and students in robotics to advocate for more diversity, inclusion, and equity in organizations to ensure that we have a seat at the table during development, test, and deployment of robotic systems so that we can advocate and amplify our collective voices for social justice and to eliminate bias, in particular in AI, machine learning, deep learning, robotics, et cetera. So as far as my journey into STEM, it is built around this concept by Kimberly Crenshaw, defined by Kimberly Crenshaw, of intersectionality. But as opposed to just looking at it from all of my multiple identities as a Black woman, I also look at it from my multiple identities as an engineer and a woman and a Black person. So Ernest Boyer in Scholarship Reconsidered stated that the work of the professoriate may be separated into four separate but overlapping functions: the scholarship of discovery, integration, application, and teaching. And there was a hope that this would give a more inclusive view of academia, where they dynamically interact to make an interdependent whole, as opposed to operating in silos. Like today I'm focusing on my teaching, or today I do research, or today I do service. And as a roboticist, this actually overlap is extremely important, and it works well because robotics is so multidisciplinary, and you can use robotics for teaching, for research, for service, for all of these things. And it also ties so closely to AI and bias, because all of these are closely interconnected with people and how people have to interact with a robot. So you always have to keep that in mind. So as part of this intersectionality, it's important to know that knowledge is acquired through research, synthesis, practice, and teaching. So as an educator, I have to do active learning with my students. I also talk to them about robotics research. I also talk to them about bias and diversity in STEM and engineering. So even if you're taking a technical course from me, you don't just focus on the technical aspects of that course, but how does your work impact others? Are you doing it ethically? Are you making sure that there's no one community that is being hurt by the products that you create? So this building block starts with the scholarship of discovery, and that's investigative research. And that's the type of research that we're all most commonly used to. But then we talk about this integration, or the synthesis across multiple disciplines, which you would expect to see a lot in robotics, because you have computer scientists, software engineers, mechanical engineers, electrical engineers, et cetera. And then the scholarship of application. Like, how do you apply your technology to consequential problems? So if I'm designing robotic systems, how could I design one to improve something? Like maybe designing a robotic system that digs wells for a community that does not have a water system, right? So I don't just want to build robots for robotics sake, but how can I take my technology and produce it to make something better about society? And then, of course, the scholarship of teaching. You know, I like to always say, to whom much is given, much is required. And if I'm acquiring all of these skills and I'm acquiring all of this knowledge, but I'm not giving it to future generations, or if I'm not using it to impact or support those that come behind me, then I am not doing it correctly. So bringing all of this together, what I like to say is I bring robotics and STEM to people, and I bring people to robotics and STEM to educate and diversify the profession. But that's a mouthful. So I wanted to come up with a way of describing what that means. And so the word I use for that is a Noir STEMinist, a Black person, a woman, an engineer who's advocating for engineering, who's advocating for diversity, more Black people in STEM, more women in STEM, but doing it by trying to do it in a non-traditional way, beyond just teaching in the classroom, and even beyond just doing traditional workshops, but reaching out on social media to connect with some of those populations that we normally may not see otherwise. And then the motto that I use for this is, my STEM is for the streets, right? So taking it out of the ivory tower, taking it out of the classroom, taking it out of those places that are normally seen as a little privileged, and bringing it down to the levels of people from all backgrounds and ethnicities and races and socioeconomic situations, so that all of them can also come together to connect. So I just went and found a couple of cartoons, because like I said, AI and robotics ethics and bias is really big right now. So there's lots of cartoons about it. One of the favorite ones that I like to show to my students is, you have an autonomous vehicle, whether it's a Tesla or whatever, and this technology now has to make decisions. So the upper left is, what does it do when it sees a little girl with a ball? We know what a human being would do, but what does the AI do? And then what happens if it's now the bottom left, whether it's either you hit two walking people or a mom and a baby? How do you make those decisions? And in this one, the autonomous vehicle is like, well, what if one of the people in the car is my mother-in-law, right? Because that might be something that a human would consider. But how can we make a computer or a robot think like a human, react like a human, talk like a human? And that's not quite an easy question to answer, because humans are a very complicated, you know, and then we're not a monolith as well. So what one human may do, another one may not. So then that bottom middle one is the robots. It's much easier when I was a battlefield bot, right? Because then maybe they didn't have to make so many ethical decisions because they were just a killing machine. And then because we know that the traditional society beyond those of us in technology, they're afraid of robots and killer robots. In the upper right, we have stop killer robots, humans, not weapons, protect our humanity. Because that's what people believe, is that robots are being built that will kill us someday. So then I like to propose that bottom right is that it cannot be either ethics or innovation, but there's got to be an integration of both. I can't say I either want to take the road that leads to ethical technology or creative innovation, but there's got to be an intersection of both. So I always highlight Asimov's laws. And I had a video on TikTok where I referred to this recently. And somebody said, well, you got to remember Asimov's laws are science fiction. And the video you're responding to is actually CGI of a robot shooting at people. It's not a real robot. And I like to say, just because it's science fiction doesn't mean that it still doesn't mean we need to have some kind of standard or ethics in our robotics research. So the first law says a robot may not injure a human being or through inaction allow a human being to come to harm. Sounds good to me and most people, right? A robot must obey orders given to it by a human, except where such orders would conflict with the first law. Still sounds reasonable. A robot must protect its own existence as long as such protection does not conflict with the first law or the second law. So what we're seeing most importantly is that the human is a big part in this loop, and that the human is going to be protected at all costs beyond the robot. Later on, there was a zeroth law added that says a robot may not harm humanity. So beyond just a human, but the human race, or by inaction, allow humanity to come to harm. So a lot of our professional organizations have a code of ethics, including IEEE, the American ACM Computing and Machinery, Association of Computing and Machinery, and several others. And so I just highlighted some of these excerpts from the IEEE Code of Ethics, which is to uphold the highest standard of integrity, responsible behavior, and ethical conduct in professional activities. To treat all persons fairly with respect to not engage in harassment or discrimination, and to avoid injuring others, and to strive to ensure this code is upheld by colleagues and coworkers. So what this means to us is no matter what kind of technology you're creating, although we're talking about robotics and AI today, we have to have some type of code of ethics and to make sure that our technology is not harming others. So what you should see here is that the levels of control for a robot go from remote control to fully autonomous. If it's a fully remote control robot, you don't necessarily need to worry so much about ethics unless the person controlling the robot has some ethical issues, because the robot is not doing any perception or independent control or thinking. As the levels of control go from fully autonomous to semi-autonomous to fully autonomous, from remote to semi-autonomous to fully autonomous, whether guided, shared, traded, supervisory, teaming, collaborative, or fully autonomous, we now have to think about ethics, because the way that the robot gets these levels of autonomy is based upon the controller, the machine learning, the AI, and how that is used or applied for this robotic system and what it will do. So now the type of data you use to train it is important. Now, the type of decisions that software is makes based upon that data is important. So as you move up this levels of control ladder and the robot becomes more intelligent in and of itself, you now have to pay attention to make sure that there's nothing you're doing that could harm others or that the robot will do that will harm others. So my field of study is actually human-robot interaction, like I said earlier. So it's just looking more at how do you understand, design, and evaluate robotic systems that will be used by or with humans. As soon as you put humans in the loop, that adds another level of complexity. I don't really know of any areas of robotics necessarily that will not have a human in the loop at some point, because even if we're talking about automation or industrial robots, they have an operator, or they may have people on the plant floor. So there has to be some level of ethical use even at that level. But the objective of human-robot interaction is to develop principles to allow for natural and effective communication between humans and robots. And this is not always looking at things like natural language processing or being able to talk, but being able to understand the human's intent or the robot's intent or their ability to collaborate or cooperate between them, not just communication necessarily, but how can they work together effectively in a space so that the human is safe and not being harmed. So as I said earlier, I think one of the wonderful things about HRI and robotics is that it involves multiple disciplines. And that also helps you because me, myself, as an electrical engineer, I need a sociologist or psychologist involved in my work because they would be better at evaluating how humans respond to it, how the robot interacts with the humans to make sure that there is no bias or harm. But there's also computer scientists, software engineers, electrical engineers, mechanical engineers, cognitive scientists. And all of these come together to make sure that we're building these systems that are benefiting humanity without harming humanity. So it's very important to never view a robot in and of itself as a technology, but as an integral system, as part of a human, and seeing them come together where that Venn diagram has an intersection that is human-robot interaction, where things you now consider for any robotic technology that you design or that you use is what are the roles of the robot and the human in this? What is the mental model? How do they each see the system and see each other? How do they behave or respond to humans? What types of expectations or interactions are reasonable? What are the modes of communication? And what are the robot's capabilities for interacting? So you want to be able to design your systems to create teams of humans and robots. And remember, there's different ways to look at those teams, thinking about semi-autonomous control, whether it's supervisory or shared or collaborative. But on some level, they are operating as a system or a team so that you can take advantage of the skills of each team member. What's best for the robot to do? What's best for the human to do? I always talk about the three D's of robotic tasks: dull, dirty, and dangerous. Those are the things you probably want the robot to do. But cognition and perception, the human may be better at that than the robot. So you have to know when to switch back and forth or exchange roles so that each is working at their top ability. And when you don't do that, then you may have communication mismatches where the robot's response and the user response may not be what's appropriate. So here is a take from the Terminator where the robot is looking for Sarah Connor and she doesn't recognize him to be a robot. And she's probably not going to say that who she is because she doesn't know who he is and looks like a man with a gun. But maybe she would say her name to this thing that just looks like a cute little robot. But looking at the communication and what's expected, what's not expected, what type of response the robot's looking for, what kind of response the human's looking for. So as part of my PhD work, I designed a compact model for artificial intelligence. It was called a sensory egosphere, and it was called that because the robot's ego is at the center. And then sensor information or data collection about the robot, it surrounds it. So that could be sonar data, compass data, laser data, images that are important for the robot's role in navigating. And then as the robot moves, this behaves like a database of information that the robot can then use as part of its artificial intelligence. So this is a way for it to have some kind of knowledge about the world without having to rely on a user or the human who is remotely controlling the robot. So this helps the robot to have its own internal model of the world, which may help with mapping or path planning and for reasoning about, you know, where are the objects that I'm most interested in, whether those are cones or balls or whatever, and having ways to represent that knowledge, in this case, representing them on the sensory egosphere. And then asking, could a user look at this and have a compact way of determining something about the robot and what's going on in its world. So in my PhD work, what I did is I would integrate this on a traditional user interface for a robot, a graphical user interface with a map and laser, compass, sonar, et cetera, and see if using that ecosphere to represent the robot's knowledge of its world would increase usability of the interface, decrease the mental workload for the user, and also increase situational awareness for the user. So does the user have a better understanding of where the robot is in the world, have a better understanding of if the robot's about to hit something, how to direct or guide the robot to somewhere in the world, if it's near an obstacle, or if they're looking for certain objects, can it identify them better by integrating the interface? So I now want to talk a little bit about where I think some of the fear for robotics comes from. And I think all of us as roboticists and researchers in this area are responsible for educating the larger community about the benefits of robotics, and then also about the things that are currently going on and being developed, the things that are not, or things that we consider to be ethical or unethical. I do want to warn you that this video is from Black Mirror Metalhead episode. So it does have some violence. And then after this, I'm going to show some other videos that have some language. So if you are not comfortable with that, I would recommend that you mute your microphone for maybe the next, I'll say 5 minutes, and then come back. Probably good enough. So give me 1 second. I'm going to reinstall this here, or maybe I'll just share it from here. How about that? That's how we'll make sure it works. Can you all see my screen? Okay. Let me go to the chat. Can you all see the YouTube? Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to play the video inside of YouTube to make sure that you can see it. Sorry, somebody let me know if you can hear the sound.
No.
I can hear it.
Thank you.
Oh, that's work better than a dog. Oh. Oh, that's R2-D2. That's R2-D2, y'all.
Where is it? Where is it? Right there, sitting down.
Never seen nothing like that in my life. R2-D2.
I never seen nothing like this before in my life. Do you see this?
Okay, and then that wasn't the only reaction to these police dogs on the streets of New York. Here are others.
New NYPD technology has some people doing a double take and asking questions. It, as you see, it's a robot that's shaped like a dog. But CBS2's Tony Aiello tells us more about the controversy about how it's being used.
Monday afternoon, 344 East 28th Street. Cops responded to a man barricaded after a domestic dispute. Sadly, an all too common situation, drawing attention because of this. One of the first times the public has seen the new NYPD DigiDog, bristling with cameras and microphones, able to approach danger and feedback live pictures and sound.
It allows them to really put a plan together to get eyes in there without putting a human body in there. It really gives you that real-time intel that is so critical to any scene like that.
MSA security consultant Justin Kelly used to command the Connecticut State.
Sorry, guys.
New NYPD technologies
able to approach danger and feedback live pictures and sound.
It allows them to really put a plan together to get eyes in there without putting a human body in there. It really gives you that real-time intel that is so critical to any scene like that.
MSA security consultant Justin Kelly used to command the Connecticut State SWAT team. He believes technology such as DigiDog can save lives and money.
There's going to be instances where they're going to be able to determine that, you know, the person's not in the residence. So a 7-hour standoff might be now 90 minutes. Like, there's savings there.
Defund the police critics sounded off on social media, portraying DigiDog as a frightening instance of over-militarized police and, with a $75,000 price tag, wasteful.
They got military gear, and now they got robot dogs in the streets, further oppressing us. We're robots now.
DigiDog is made by Boston Dynamics, which continues to develop accessories, including arm attachments. NYPD policy outlines limited use of the robot for situational awareness at dangerous scenes. The mayor says he'll speak with cops about it.
If in any way it's unsettling to people, we should rethink the equation.
Police robots have been around since the 1970s. Never quite like this. Tony Aiello, CBS 2 News.
Okay, one other video. Representative Jamal Brown was shown in that clip. I was going to show you a little bit of his reaction. But one of the things they talk about is that these robots are used to deliver food to hostages, to scout out a location where there's a gunman. But the backlash becomes is we already know about bias in policing against Black and Brown people. And now how does this technology affect that? And, you know, people feel like these are misplaced priorities and over-policing in our communities as usual. And then when you think about the cost of them, the fact that they're $70,000 each, but yet, you know, there's problems in schools like mold in residents and lead paint. But, you know, they have money that they can spend on these robot dogs. I think the backlash result ended up being, I believe they pulled them from the streets. of New York. But there's a lot of articles about why should we be worried about this? Because they're being used by police. And we know even when we have no police dogs in the loop, there's been bias against people. So what happens with the police violence, the racism, the brutality, and the unnecessary killing, where you now also have dogs in the loop? What if these dogs become fully autonomous, or these dogs are now outfitted with weapons? What kind of decision-making will it have? What kind of autonomy will it have? We already know that there's bias and inaccuracy in AI decision-making. So how will this play a part now that we have robots as part of it? So what the public's outcry is about: full transparency, meaningful limitations, and community control over police surveillance. They also talk about that there's now a commitment by some roboticists, part of the Algorithmic Justice League, to sign a commitment that they will not work with police and military to make sure that their technology is not used by these communities. So here's the last video I want to show you, and then I'm going to go back to the other slides.
Peace and love, everyone. So all summer, we in these streets protesting for Black lives. We screaming Black Lives Matter. We're marching in solidarity with people from across the city and across the country. We're standing up to police brutality directly. And what did we get in return? We got police attacking people, brutalizing people, assaulting people for just walking down the street. We got another killing of Dante Wright. We got the murder of George Floyd, and we got Breonna Taylor and so many others that we can't comprehend. We scream defund the police so we can reallocate those resources towards something that focuses on true public health and public safety. Protesting all summer for Black lives, we were under assault. People living in poverty, struggling to put food on the table, keep a roof over their head, take care of their kids, afford childcare. All this going on. And now we got damn robot police dogs walking down the street. What the hell do we need robot police dogs? This is some RoboCop shit. This is crazy. Robot police dogs walking down the street. So we're saying we need police reform, we need racial justice, we need economic justice. We protesting for Black lives. People pushing back against the fund of police. Oh, we need police and this and that. We need robot police dogs. That's what we need. So now, not only do I feel physically occupied in my community by too many police, now y'all bringing robot police to occupy my community. So you can't give me a living wage. You can't raise the minimum wage. You can't give me affordable housing. I'm working hard. I can't get paid leave. I can't get affordable child care. Instead, we got money, taxpayer money, going towards robot police dogs. Taxpayers fund the police. Taxpayers need to stand up and say enough is enough, because that's crazy right there. That's what you do when you got too much money. They got military gear. And now they got robot dogs in the streets, further oppressing us. We're robots now. It's crazy. We need to end that. Peace.
So humans must be an integral part of the research, development, and deployment process. And like I told you before, this is a challenge. We're researchers, we're technologists, and we're also Black and brown people. So we can see both sides to this. But we can't let our technology be misrepresented or misused. So that means that we have to be part of it. So here is another tweet from Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez talking about, shout out to everyone who fought against community advocates who demanded these resources go to investments like school counseling instead. Now robotic surveillance ground drones are being deployed for testing on low-income communities of color with under-resourced schools. And then, of course, somebody said, in case this does come into your community, let me help you figure out how to disable it without crushing your fingers. So these are all the things that we have to consider as we're designing our technology, because we know it's important and we want to be able to do it. But we also want to make sure that it benefits our people in the process of doing that. Please confirm for me that you can see my slides again.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So, yes, we can.
Okay, thank you. So can we make our robots less biased than we are is the question. If we know that people are part of the human robot system loop and that we are involved in creating the technology for AI and machine learning, then unfortunately things that can happen is our biases show up in our technology. So many of today's algorithms are biased against people of color and others who are unlike the white, male, affluent, and able-bodied designers of most computer and robot systems. Another of my colleagues, Cindy Bethel, says, I was dismayed to find that there has been a blanket statement released about roboticists committing to not work with the police and help with technology. She feels that it is naive and not well-informed because she works with local and state police and focuses on robot projects that can make police work safer for both officers and civilians. And I think this just shows an example of this is not a black and white issue. It's a gray area. Black and in computing also sounded the alarm and had a call to action that stated technologies we help create to benefit society are also disrupting black communities through the proliferation of racial profiling. So we have to make sure that that's not happening. And there was also the release of the No Justice, No Robots manifesto that I referred to earlier, which commits its signers to refusing to work with or for law enforcement agencies on their technology, with their technology. So here are a couple of examples of where we have recently seen bias show up in not just robotics, but in artificial intelligence. It's always present when decisions are being made on based on prior information or experience, and that data is limited because it can then have bias based upon protected characteristics like race, ethnicity, age, gender. And the first step in correcting for bias is being aware that it exists. So this is Charles Isbell, and he is an AI researcher at Georgia Tech. And about a year or so ago, Twitter released an algorithm that would take highly pixelated images and clean them up on social media. And it was immediate uproar because it was discovered that they always made the images into a white man, no matter what the original image looked like. So they showed that if it was a picture of Barack Obama, it became a white man. If it was a picture of Charles Isbell, it became a white man. And I believe if it was a woman, it became a white woman. I'm not quite sure about that. So here was one of our first examples of seeing how AI can be used appropriately or inappropriately. Whereas if there had just been someone in that room, a person of color, to go, have you tested this on anyone else to see how it works on other people, they would have seen that. But the worst part about it is just, you know, not seeing how, yeah, it's funny that it's making these highly pixelated images into a white person. But what about when police departments start to rely on this technology to make decisions about crimes? Bias can lead to decisions that negatively impact a protected group. Whether intentional or not, it can actually cause injustice. And this implicit bias is based on these hurting these marginalized groups. So over here, we have Robert Williams. And actually, since Robert Williams' arrest in 2020, there has actually been a second person arrested. One of them was in Detroit, and I believe the other one was in Pennsylvania, where they used artificial intelligence technology, which we know has been proven to be faulty based upon coded bias, which Joy Bulumawimi and several others released a documentary about earlier this year. And he was arrested for shoplifting in a store because they took this grainy digital image and sent it through this facial recognition system and compared it to his driver's license photo and arrested him in front of his family. And he had just recently gotten out of the hospital from having a stroke. And just recently, after he was finally cleared from this faulty AI facial recognition software, he is now suing the police department for false arrest. So I think it's very important to see that machine learning uses these models to make assumptions, and they're based upon the information accessible. A lot of times there may be less information available on minoritized and marginalized groups. So if the majority of the data is coming from white males, then that is going to unfairly bias the system because it's now encoded into the system. So you have to be very careful about what type of real-world data is being used to train the model, and does it represent the true population? And if when it comes out the other side, it's faulty because you got to evaluate it and test it, then you have to do something to correct that before sending it out into the society as a whole. And so like I mentioned earlier, Joy Bulamwini has this documentary, Coded Bias, when the robot doesn't see dark skin. And she discovered this when she was doing a graduate project where she wanted to use facial recognition and realized it would only recognize her face when she put on a white mask. So what do we do? How, you know, the technology is going to keep coming. We're going to be involved in creating technology. How do we solve this problem? There has to be better engineering, more detailed, thorough design methods where it's evaluated at every turn. And you have to have diverse teams that work on these implementation methods or get users from diverse backgrounds to make sure that it's all being evaluated and that it is working appropriately. So you have to have rooms of people like this to change the game. And this is part of why I do the work that I do, why Black in Robotics, Black in Engineering does the work that we do, because we need to become normalized, promoted, supported, and more ubiquitous in these spaces so that these organizations stop saying, well, we couldn't find a Black person or we couldn't find a woman engineer. And so they just continue making this technology that we know has this bias. We know we exist and we know that we're helping grow more. So we have to be there to correct for that. And I'm using Cyril's image here because I liked it. We have to get people of all ages, races, ethnicities excited about STEM. That's why Black in Robotics Outreach did this 3-week series for the African connections, as well as all of the workshops and things we do, like with HBCU students and with K-12 students, because we have to be in that room. This is how we eliminate bias. We have to be there to speak to it and go, hey, has this been tested on brown skin? Is that soap dispenser going to recognize my hand if I try to get soap out of it? Or does it only work for peach hands or light skinned colors? We have to be there to have those conversations that others may not be aware of or be comfortable having. So the role of Black in Robotics is to bring together Black researchers, industry professionals, and students in robotics to mutually support one another to help navigate academic, corporate, and entrepreneurial paths to success, to advocate for more diversity, equity, and inclusion within the organizations that we live and work in, and to ensure that we have a seat at the table during the development, test, and deployment of robotic systems that affect our communities. And once again, to amplify our collective voices for calls for social justice. So this means there have to be strategies for addressing bias, like the Black in Robotics reading list. If you're looking for a researcher or you want to refer to a researcher of color in your work, there's also citeher.org and a couple of others that are for women researchers as well as Black women researchers to make sure that you're listening to and hearing from diverse voices when you are doing your work. Developers must consider ethical implications of robotics usage. Educators must include ethics and societal questions in training. Teams must be diverse to provide unique perspectives and solutions. And researchers must reference the work of diverse roboticists. As I said, the Black in Robotics reading list is a great beginning to doing that. And then as part of addressing some systemic inequities in robotics, our community has to come together through networking, mentorship, and a social media presence so we can highlight when we see this bias and that us as a community can speak against it, right? And also that there is advocacy by showcasing and normalizing Black excellence in robotics, connect academia and industry to diverse talent, and support and defend equity in performance and ethical use. There needs to be accountability, a conduit for all roboticists to participate in solutions. Events like we're having today are a great way to have accountability, where we come together and identify best practices and hold each other accountable for equitable designs. And to actively promote diversity in developing teams in academia and industry, ensure that bias is considered in the research and application of robotic systems, and make bias training and its effect in robotic applications and methods in order to mitigate a harm component in the curriculum as well, right? Start when young people are in high school or middle school or college, as you're teaching them robotics, bring ethics into that process. One of the things my students love to do when we do robotics competitions is they always want to help me come up with the idea for the competition by talking about shooting another robot or shooting a person or shooting a Nerf gun or battle bots or damaging robots. And everything is just so violent and so aggressive. And that opens the door for a great conversation about ethics and doing no harm. And can we stop visualizing ways and using technology with weaponry or with this military perspective? So with that, I apologize for some of the technical issues with the videos. I am actually done. I have provided several hyperlinks here. My Twitter, which recently got unsuspended, so we're happy about that. Instagram and TikTok, blackinengineering.org, blackinrobotics.org, norahsteminis.com, which is my company, and also a blog that I recently wrote about a lot of the same things that I mentioned in the presentation about freeing robotics and AI from bias. So with that, I am ready to take questions. You can either put your questions in the chat or you can come off of mute and ask. Oh, we are ready for questions. I see you guys were chatting in the chat, but any questions? And once again, even though I'm saying any questions, remember, I am not a AI ethics or robotics expert by any means. I just discuss it from the lens of what I do, because I do believe that anyone who is doing technology that's going to be used in society, then it is very important that you consider these aspects of it, no matter what your area of research is.
Sure, this is Maurice or Mo. I just wanted to state something. So in my field with the cybersecurity, we're looking at AI to help identify anonymous online extremists, local homegrown terrorists in America. And so what we're doing is we're looking at AI to kind of sort through this process that we created and remove the need to have a human in the loop to go through all this identification of, you know, what does this mean? What particular white power group this could be, white supremacy group this could be, and stuff like that. And so for us, it's helped out, but that's pretty much just a program that we're doing in Python and stuff like that.
Right.
In relation to like drones or unmanned systems, I was previously in aerospace and defense. I worked in Textron systems, so AEI, which does the Predator, not the Predator. They manage a Predator in terms of the ground control station, but then they have the shadow UAV. And so that was something that was used as well. But again, that was a wartime scenario, right? So we were supporting the warfighter and identifying potential terrorism stuff. What's interesting is that behind the actual UAV, you have someone flying it, but it's not someone just, it's not AI used to identify, maybe help identify probably in the future.
Right.
But you always have a person behind the system. So you have like two operators. You have someone that's flying the actual drone and then someone identifying targets. And so I think that becomes really critical when you think about how that particular unmanned system is going to be used. So like, you know, you mentioned the whole ordeal about the dog. I don't think it's that much an issue if you have AI assisted, because you still need some type of human in the background to say, okay, well, let me see what the actual image that came through and let me identify it with an actual real known threat. I think that is still a big thing. And I think perhaps legislation, whether it's city government, state, or federal, needs to come in and play on the actual use of these instruments.
I agree. I actually agree with that. One of the things I had earlier, maybe before you arrived, looked at those levels of control, and somebody actually just put that in the chat as well, is until you get to fully autonomous, we hopefully do have a human in the loop that could pull back, like whether it's supervisory control or shared control, and said, okay, I need to take the reins back now, because there's something about this that's not going correctly. I think where this really becomes a problem is when we're looking at these fully autonomous systems And even the ones that in the future where they talk about it learns as it grows, where the AI is now regenerating itself by inputs. And there was an example in the last couple of years, I can't remember what, I think it may have been Google, where they put out a chat bot that they wanted to learn by interacting, and they had to take it down within like 24 hours because it had become misogynistic and racist and bigoted. So once again, that whole garbage in and garbage out. But I do agree with you that as long as there's a person in the loop that is assessing that data and the perception, right? Because that's the hard part about AI or robotics even, is can you look at data and make decisions and make good decisions about what you're seeing and what you should do with it? Like thinking about what you said your company is working on, I know a lot of times this aggressive AI will take down tweets that are just maybe something between two friends, like, oh my God, I'm so jealous of your new shoes, I could kill you. And then the AI, if it doesn't have a human who's looking at it, they're like, oh, they said kill, take it down, right? Or, you know, the AI on my daughter's school laptop is so strict, she can't even Google things for a simple book report if it's any of the target words that their AI is looking for. So I think we have to keep humans in the loop for that. But then what happens if we get to the point where we want these fully autonomous systems that can actually learn, you know, and generate on their own? That's a challenge.
Now, Carlotta, I think that's interesting when you talk about that, because with these systems, it all depends upon who they're learning from. And nowhere I know that there's a certified program and bias and stuff like that, because we're all biased in our own ways.
That's true.
Whether we're from a particular country, a particular religion or denomination, all this stuff would affect how the AI learns if it's learning from a particular person.
Right.
And like you mentioned, and I remember exactly when you're talking about the misogynist and the racism, these were the individuals interacting with the actual bot. And so based upon those interactions, now that particular AI is like whom it's been interacting with. And so they think that's okay, because that is, you know, what they've experienced in their short period of life, we'll say.
So then the question becomes, do we have an AI inside the AI that goes, when certain data comes in, you put that in a different box than this AI?
Yeah,
is that even a thing? You know,
because it's like you have to have a brain for the actual machine, right? So now you got to figure out, how do you construct that? And then how do you construct that in a way that it doesn't change over time? Because we as people, we change over time, right? We change religions. We change our thought process. You know, I was growing up in the military household, I was very pro-military. Now I'm like, you know, support my country, but there's some things that need to be thought of, you know. And so what are the controls in place for making sure that this AI is truly unbiased? But the problem is, AI is supposed to change and grow. It's supposed to be, it's an artificial intelligence, so it should shape. So how do you guide that shape? And then who is actually knowledgeable enough to understand, you know, growing that? I mean, as parents, we struggle to raise our kids hoping that they become one way. This AI is just an accelerated kid.
Yeah. And then what person, right? You know, I talk about that a lot of these rooms are mostly white, privileged white male. So no wonder, you know, the facial recognition system was trying to convert all highly pixelated images to white males. But I also don't want a room full of only Black people either. So you kind of got to have a diversity of opinions in that space. Who talk and interact and engage in order to design these systems, because any one group is going to obviously bias towards whatever their beliefs are. Because you're right, everyone has bias. It's just a matter of how that bias is used, and is it going to lead to injustice or impacting marginalized groups in some way? Are there any other comments or questions? I see there's some stuff in the chat, but I'm not totally reading it either.
I have one last question. So
do you run
a short seminar on something like this? Aside from this, do you do anything at your institution?
Not my institution. I do more of this type of work through Black in Robotics. And when people reach out to me to do things, I do it through my company. At my school, not so much. I'm at a teaching school. I'm not at a school that, we do research with undergraduates, but like we don't really have graduate students. So I don't do too much of this through my school, but I do more of it through the outreach work that I do through Black in Robotics and Black in Engineering, or if people just reach out to me because they found me on social media.
Okay, I asked that because so at the university I'm at Illinois Institute of Technology. Mm-hmm. And so we have like the only graduate program in AI, master's in AI and bachelor's in AI. And we're here in Chicago. We're actually in the South Side.
Very cool.
And that's a whole nother story because our institution doesn't represent the actual Black community at all. But, you know, I run a conference called Shy CyberCon. And so we want to get someone to speak on AI. And, you know, an issue like bias would be interesting because we're rolling in Homeland Security, intelligence. Mm-hmm. We have a partnership with U.S. Strategic Command, also with NORAD. And we're trying to get us, I think that's pretty much all that's here. But, you know, people of color, people of African descent into this particular space because we're missing out on so much. Because, you know, you look at average AI salaries with a master, you're looking well in the 120s. But it's a way of changing communities. So that's one of the things that we do with the conference is reach out to communities and say, hey, these are the topics that exist. And I would actually love to have you as a speaker. If you have like 30 minutes available, it can be pre-recorded or you can actually speak live, but it's next year, April. But okay. Yeah, the whole AI piece would be great. The bias part would be great because, you know, students are learning about, okay, well, I'm going to write this particular piece of code. What can it do? Because we're trying to incorporate AI, cybersecurity, and data science into everything.
Mm-hmm. I actually have a speaking agent, Mo. So if you could get I can't talk. I'm going to type my email in the chat. That'll probably be the easiest thing. I was going to say get it from Angela, but then I was thinking I can just type it in the chat. And then if you reach out to me, I can connect you with my speaking agent because the pandemic has shown that I get a lot of speaking requests, so I let them handle all of that in my calendar. But if you email me, we can talk about doing that. And it could be virtual, like I don't necessarily have to travel to Chicago, even though I am in Indianapolis, right?
Yeah, it's going to be through, it's going to be virtual because of the pandemic. And so in our state, okay. We have a lot of things changing with, you know, laws regarding COVID. Okay. We still have a certain amount of population that don't want to get vaccinated. So yeah, things have been changing rapidly.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, if you could just shoot me an email, we'll connect up on that. Okay.
Okay. So I think we have just some few questions in the chat.
Okay.
So So someone asked if the recorded version, recordings of this meeting is going to be made available. So I think you can.
I can. I need to clean it up a little bit, and I can put it on YouTube. We have, okay. We're right now, I believe we're putting them either under Black in Engineering or under my personal YouTube channel because Black in Robotics doesn't have a YouTube channel yet. But yeah, I can send it to you, Cyril, or we can just send it out to the whole group that registered for the event after okay, we get the video fine. Cleaned up.
Okay, that's fine. So the second question is from the chat. It said, He said, hello, everyone. Is there any similarity between bias and low level of autonomy in robotics?
I think Mo brought this up a minute ago, but I think it really is tied to the humans in the loop, as well as at the higher levels of autonomy, it's going to be tied to the data used to train the system, as well as the way the code is written based upon that data, right? At the lower levels of autonomy, the bias could show up based upon the humans in the loop and what they're doing. Because if the robot, for example, has low autonomy, then it's getting its autonomy from the human. And since all humans have some level of bias, it could still happen. Like if you think about the video I showed with the police officer with the digidog, I think the digidog is completely remote control, but we all know that police officers can make bias or racially biased decisions. So there's nothing that says that the police officer can't then do that with the dog. So I think at both levels, you could see that.
Okay, so I think the last question, I guess, is, you said, okay, not a question, he said, that's Adebo Bajo, okay. He said, I really love to develop an autonomous AI UAV that can autonomously track and neutralize targets. How can we make this machine to subdue human control? An example of this in STM cargo drone development by Turkish Armed Forces. Okay, so we are not making drones here. Okay, so but I think from what this is trying to talk about is how can you make this machine to subdue, to subdue human control?
I think stuff like that may already exist. I don't know. This isn't my area, but I'm pretty sure they actually have military drones and things like that can target certain, target certain targets. I know I'm overusing that word, but I believe something like that may already exist, but I don't really know. That's not really my area.
This is Mo. So yeah, you do have stuff that exists. So it all depends on the class of UAVs or drones. Yeah. When I talk about class, the classes, they're all rated against, I believe, how the impact if they fall or something like that. But some drones are more advanced than others. So when you look at things like General Atomics Predator, right, it's huge. It has the ability to actually launch missiles and stuff like that. Those are pretty advanced. But when you have others that are just for ISR, intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance, that aren't armed, they do have some ability to recognize various areas and stuff like that. And so you have to think about that type of, they do have that stuff. And then when you look at larger rotary wing aircraft, I'm talking about helicopters, years ago, they were trying to make those fully autonomous, but those were to recognize various things. And it's important because they have something called DTED, which is Digital Terrain Environmental Database. And it is able to render things versus so many meteor postings and stuff like that. But all that depends upon the amount of, I guess, memory rendering, the actual data sets, stuff like that. Well, data sets, talking about the actual database that contains all the landscape. But yeah, so the larger the actual drone is, the more it will be able to withstand. And also the support system and stuff like that, which I'm talking about is the ground control station. But yeah, so in short, answer is yes. But that's kind of like the slew of all the things tied together.
Thank you, Mel.
So I think someone has the hands up, like John Foster. So before I take the last question.
Okay,
so John Foster.
Yes, good afternoon, everyone. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, great. First, I want to thank you, Dr. Berry, for having this presentation. I think I've learned a lot, over the listening and, paying attention to the slides and everything. But one of the things that you mentioned was, how does the work impact others? Okay, and I think that that's key. Just from from what I've learned is how the work impacts others. And you showed the video with the robot dog, and so I'm thinking when you have something like that that's out in the public and it's being seen and people are even with the comments and everything. My thought is that. That didn't happen by accident, and that there are legislators who determine where the bunny goes, and and they are the ones that kind of they're the ones who are impacting whether or not that robot dog is on the streets, basically.
Right.
And so my thing is, I wanted to see just from you all, from whoever on here has has any experience or has any kind of knowledge about STEM that teaches it, the majority of you do. Have you noticed an increase in the interest from legislators? Because my thing is, we talk about us all coming together and making this important. We have to start at the level where the legislation is made, because that's where that's how these things even occur. It doesn't happen in a bubble. So we have to engage with legislators. So do you all have any consistent contact with people, with legislators who are saying, yeah, we're going to do this and we're going to talk about this bias and we're going to make sure that it doesn't impact legislation? Do you all have a constant relationship with any legislators who are interested in making sure that, that the impact doesn't affect Black and Brown communities, negatively? And if that being the case, what can we do, or how can we begin to engage with legislators to let them know that this is important to us in our community, so that these effects don't have a negative impact on our communities in particular?